function called f. That's negative 5 times negative 2 plus 2, that's 10 plus 2, 12. F of 0, much easier than that, we get 0 plus 2. 2. That's 2. F of 5?
Negative 25.
Negative 5 times 5. Plus 2, that's going to be negative 25 plus 2 is negative 23. Alright, 16. R of x, this function is called r, and its input is x. R of x equals negative 4/5 x plus 7. Okay, maybe almost kind of a...
Oh,
what's he got up here? Yeah, Aiden?
So you,
R of x.
X equals 15.
Okay, how do we figure that out?
Oh, I just plugged it in.
Okay, well, one important thing that you understand, at least, is that R of x equals negative 5 is not the same as R of negative 5, right? What's the difference?
No, you gotta do a little subtraction before.
What's the difference here?
That it doesn't say of. That's the answer that it comes out to.
That's the answer that comes out. That's the output. We figure out the input. Okay, let's face forward. Sorry, face forward. Thanks. So that's the output, right? That is what we get for some x that we plugged in. We just gotta figure out what that x was. So here is the function. R of x, there it is. And it's equal to negative 5. The output is negative 5. What's the input?
Alpha 5. Input.
Let's figure that out. Subtract 7 from both sides. Negative 4/5 equals negative 12.
Ooh.
Negative 4/5 x equals negative 12. Multiply by the reciprocal. Multiply by negative 5/4. Multiply by negative 5/4. X equals 4 divides negative 12 to be negative 3. Negative 3 times negative 5.
Negative. Oh, yeah.
Opposites are 15.
Confusing. It's confusing.
What's confusing?
I don't
know. I guess. Okay. 25.
See what number 25
is? 25. We're just graphing. And to graph a function in function notation is no different than graphing it when it says y equals.
Have you got our stuff ready?
If you are finished.
You haven't handed it back.
I'm not going to hand it back. So many people haven't done it yet.
Can we just like look at it and then give it back?
Yes, later you can. Number 25, f of x equals 3/5 x plus 2. To graph f of x equals 3/5 x plus 2 is exactly the same as to graph y equals 3/5 x plus 2, except like maybe the only difference could be like, what difference can we start off with here on the x and y axis?
Change the y to f of x.
Change the y to f of x, right? You don't have to. Absolutely don't have to. You can still call it the y axis. Okay.
It means the same thing.
Be that picky. But it's not uncommon to call it the f of x axis. It's the function, or it's the axis that tracks the output of the function. Well, it still has a y-intercept of 2. If I were to plug in a 0, I'd get 2. Yeah, if I were to plug in 5, then it would wind up being 3 more than 2, so I would also get a 5. So, by 5, up 3, that's the slope.
Ah, that's what you gotta get.
Yeah. Maybe black.
Oh boy.
Same as y equals 3/5 x plus 2, just instead it says f of x equals 3/5 x plus 2. If you put x axis and y axis, it's fine. fine. Like, it would mark you off even on a test if you didn't put f of x axis. That's good. Minor set of the slope, same deal as before. Any questions?
Not necessarily.
Richard?
This feels like the same thing as what we've been doing, but you're just saying different things.
We're just getting
variable.
Yeah, we're just like getting used to hot water in a jacuzzi or something. We're just kind of hanging out and realizing it's still water. It's a little different. It's a little uncomfortable. But then we get used to it. We get used to the function notation and what it means to write f parentheses 2, right? You get that. We become acclimated to that.
I get
acclimated
to it when I just get ready to it.
Because you're an amazing superhero. So f of negative 2 means that negative 2 is going to replace x in the function f. 2 times negative 2 minus 8, that's negative 4 minus 8, negative 12. Right, g of 6, the function g is going to get x of 6. So 2 thirds times 6 over 1. 3 divided by 6 is 2. 2 times 2 is 4. 4 plus 2.
Is that right? Like what you said, fx equals negative 12.
Yeah, it's okay. It's not true. F of x.
Well, I didn't know really what to put.
F of negative 2 equals negative 12. So not f of x.
Oh, I put fx.
Negative 2.
Oh, I put f. Or am I wrong?
No, not this time. All right. But if we want to give our final answer, we'd be like, okay, so what I'm telling you is the function f, when you plug negative 2 into it, you get negative 12. If I say f of x, now f of x is just the number negative 12. Like, that's all there is to the function, but that's not the case here.
On our test, would we get that wrong if you wrote it like how I wrote it?
I'd probably just remind you.
And if you already reminded us
after school.
No, let's say, let's do this. On the quiz, no. On when that stuff rolls over and becomes a test, then yes. How's that sound? That's plenty of time to get used to that idea. F of negative 2.
Is our test like going to be next week then?
Could be. I don't know with maps and stuff.
We have maps testing.
It's coming up. The thing I want you to graph is a simple function, f of x is equal to function. 3/4 x plus 2. Okay. But wait, don't graph it yet.
Gosh darn it.
Because what I want you to do is to graph this only if x is greater than or equal to negative 4. And I feel like, what in the world are you asking me for? Do your best. Like, use what you know about
if x is what?
X is greater than or equal to negative 4. And I'm saying if x is not greater than or equal to negative 4, I don't want you to graph this graph. But if it is, I want you to graph this graph. Take like 30 seconds. Do your best. See what you think this graph should look like if I put this restraint on it. Like I said, the graph should only exist if the x value is greater than or equal to negative 4. So let's just look at that. Let's look at where this is true and where it's not true. Okay. Where is x greater than or equal to negative 4? Yeah.
4.
4, certainly it is. Okay. So right at this place, right? I don't really want to make too many marks because we're not actually graphing anything yet, but at 4, is x greater than or equal to 4?
Yeah.
Should the graph exist there?
Yeah.
So there's some point, right? It's maybe it's up here, down here, maybe it's there, wherever it winds up being, it should be plotted. What about where else is x greater than or equal to negative 4?
Negative 4 and above.
Negative 4 and above. Okay, so negative 4, here's negative 4, right? X is negative 4.
Mm-hmm. That's negative 6.
Negative 4. And above, where is above? To the right. Okay. So then, like, this is kind of a cutoff. I'm not graphing, do not draw this. I'm about to erase this in a second. Just to give you a visual, like, kind of seeing what I'm seeing. I'm going to show you it in my mind. What I know is off limits. Where I don't want to see the graph. I do not want to see it over here. This is not part of the graph. I would not graph it this way. I wouldn't shade it in. There's no shading required. Okay, definitely all of these points are not valid if I'm considering that shaded in. But I know that all of this stuff is, no, I do not want the graph to be there. I only want the graph to be over here. It's like the graph is there, and you just put a piece of paper over the x values that you don't want to include, and you don't see anything there. You don't see that graph. Well, okay, so I know that the graph should exist over in this region, but not over here. What about right at negative 4? Should I show that it's there or not show that it's there?
Yes, because it's more than or equal to.
Yes, or equal to, greater than or equal to. So at negative 4 also, I want the graph to exist. Okay, so let me just take all this out of here.
Wouldn't it be a solid line here?
Right, so I'm about to create it, to graph it, but none of that stuff is actually part of the graph. So, well, just graph it like normal. It has a y-intercept of 2, has a slope of 3/4, so I can go over 4 and up 3. Okay, so there's all this. That graph should be there. That part of the graph should be there because it is in the area where x is greater than.
You said not to, you said not to graph it.
If it is greater than or equal to
negative 4. Let's keep the earbuds out of our ears.
No, I'm listening, but you... Why are you graphing it? Not just graph it because you didn't take the graph. You
just
said
went
not
over all this. Said, if, like, all of this space, since it's less than negative 4, x is less than negative 4 over here, don't want to see any graph over here. Whatever we are over here, yes, and look at where this graph is, it's over there, to the right. So yeah, that graph is okay. Let's look at like the points. This point is 4, 5. Well, x is 4. Is that greater than or equal to negative 4?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is that the x value is, and so yes, we do want the graph to exist there. How about this one is 8?
Yeah.
Comma 8.
Yeah.
That's okay. That x value is greater than negative 4. How about this one? This is 0, 2. Is that
yeah.
One okay?
Yeah.
That's greater than negative 4. I can follow the slope backward. Go back to here. Right. The left 4, down 3. Should I see the graph in here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So x is a negative 1. So x is negative 2, negative 3. All those x values are greater than negative 4. So yeah. This point right here, it's at negative 4, negative 1. Should I show that
yes.
point or no?
Yeah,
because
it's negative 4.
Equal to
negative 4?
Yeah, you did that right.
Over here?
No,
I do. Just stop graphing it. When you get to right there, you just stop. No more of that. There it is. It's graphed. So what I did here is I messed around with the domain. I told you what the domain could be. Usually the domain for this function is whatever you want x to be, because there's no problem. 3/4 times x. Any number could be multiplied by 3/4. So the domain's usually all real numbers, anything you want. But this time I said only if x is greater than or equal to negative 4. And so the graph is only shown, those points are only included if the x part of the point is greater than or equal to negative 4. And certainly it's a graph. You could just leave it at that. But I want to add to it. I'm trying to learn this whole subject, not just half of it. So if I tell you to graph negative 1/2 x minus 3 if x is, let's just make it all the other x's, less than negative 4. So we've seen an example of if x is greater than or equal to negative 4. So, yeah, negative 4. So x is less than negative 4, this would be all the other x's that are available. Well, let's graph that function. Thank you. So we're really just going to graph this function the same as we would normally. Just want to make sure it does not show up. It does not exist. We do not make it visible unless x is less than negative 4. So if it's anything that's bigger than that or exactly equal to negative 4, we're not going to graph that graph. This is the graph, this other one that we've already graphed, for that, for when x is greater than or equal to negative 4. Okay. So we've got a y-intercept of, okay, let's kind of color code what we've got going on here. So we got the y-intercept of negative 3. Now am I supposed to show this graph here at this point?
No. Because
the x is not less than 4, so you'll make just a small mark or a mark that I'm going to be sure to erase later. Right? That's going to help me get over that way where I want to be. So we'll left 2 up 1. Okay, well, still this graph should not be shown here. Left 2 up 1 again. Look at that, just happens to be at the same place. It didn't have to be. Like, if I did this as a minus 4 instead of a minus 3, then we would have wound up there. But we started at minus 3, left 2 up 1, left 2 up 1. There we go. Now we can start showing this graph once we get to the left of negative 4. Really, though, it happened to just be in the same place. So that point is there. They meet right there at this kind of a V shape.
No.
Is that?
But the other one can't be 4, so it wouldn't go all the way to 4.
Right, so this one doesn't come all the way to negative 4. But as soon as we get to negative 4, we switch over to this one, and it, like, these, both of these at negative 4 have the same y value. So it's like just kind of works out that way. So left 2 and up 1 again.
I thought we can't go past it.
Well, only for this one. This one can't go past it. But this one, right, is only for when x is less than negative 4, like this guy right here. This is negative 6, 0. That x value of that point is less than negative 4. So if you want that graph to be there. So at this negative 4 value, again, this dotted line I'm drawing is not part of the graph. It's just to help you to see. There is this value of x is negative 4. Bigger than negative 4, we want to show this guy here, right? That's what this piece of instruction is saying. Less than negative 4, we want to show this function, which has a y-intercept of negative 3 and a slope of negative 1/2. Right at negative 4, again, we want to use this top function. Okay? So that point is the one we use.
So we would do the point negative 4, but it would be an open circle?
Yeah, if they didn't happen to just meet up like they do here,
yeah.
They do meet up, then yeah, it would be an open circle. So we can decide to see like a gap between them, and then one would have an open circle, but the other one has a closed. Very good. So any questions about that? Because I'm about to just give you a piecewise function. Well, you've never heard that before, probably. This is called a piecewise, making sure I was using the right piece. Let's call it a piecewise function. Does the name piecewise make sense? The graph you see here?
Yes.
Why does it make sense, do you think?
Because you're only doing a piece of the function.
Doing a piece of this function, piece of that function. We could do pieces of all sorts of functions. We could have 5 functions cut into pieces and Frankenstein together into what we call a piecewise function. Okay. So we'll talk about a piecewise function in a minute that is more applicable to real life. Okay. But let's just practice graphing piecewise functions. Let me give you a piecewise function. F of x is equal to two different functions like 4/3 x minus 3 if x is greater than or equal to 3 and negative 1/3 x minus 1 if x is less than this. I like to start with the one that includes zero, so I can just throw the y intercept on there and leave it. It's a few. This one includes zero, right? Because zero is less than three. This one I'll show the y intercept of negative one. Draw that point. It's got a slope of negative 1/3. Go back 3 and up 1. We'll plug in negative 3 and see what the y value you get. It goes to 0. Goes all the way up to, but not quite all the way to 3. Right? So if I were to follow the slope, I'd go to the right 3 and down 1 and put a point, right? But I'm not supposed to show this graph. I'm not supposed to graph this graph at 3. So how do I graph it without graphing?
You mark the 3 and then draw a line.
So you just kind of draw the line from there?
Oh yeah, I drew a line just going up and then.
Like that, you mean?
No, I mean, never mind.
Never mind, I just don't, I'm just not understanding what you're saying.
Like the 3, since it says if it's less than 3, so. Well, never mind, you're supposed to do that too.
So how do I show like it gets really close to
open circle?
Yeah. Open circle. Say this graph, we'll use this graph for all values of x that are less than 3, but when we get right to 3, no, we don't use this graph. We use this other graph. We use this other graph when x is 3 or greater. Right? Greater than or equal to 3. We still would like to use that y-intercept. So I'll go ahead and use that y-intercept of negative 3, 1, 2, 3. And I'll just kind of make a small point, just a mental note that that's where it's coming from. Show a slope of 4/3, so 1, 2, 3, 4, let's see. 1, 2, oh, 3, not negative. 1, 2, 3, 4, and over 3. And that puts me on an x of 3, so you know, that's what I... I want that point to be included. I can just show that slope again, up 4 to the right 3. And now I have 2 points to graph my line. I'll use that solid point, built-in point there. There we go. Some arrows on there. We got a piecewise function, piecewise defined function. Now, a special kind of piecewise function is just like little pieces, what we call a step function. So it'll be one function between here and there, and then it'll stop, and then it'll just step up here, and then go from here to there, it'll step up again, and then see the graph. So it'll look like a staircase almost. And I think an example we're all familiar with as far as step functions is Redbox. You guys all use Redbox before?
Yep. The red movie.
The red movies. Kyle, you have a question?
On the last graph, how come you started at -2 on the graph with the open circle?
Yeah. With the open circle?
Yeah.
Why did I start at -2? We didn't start at -2. I mean, I had the y-intercept of -1, and then following the slope.
Oh, yeah, okay,
one,
so you went
down.
Okay, yeah.
So Redbox is a kind of function where it doesn't gradually go up, right? You rent a movie for one night, and how much does it cost you?
$0.99.
$1.50.
$1.50?
Oh wait, no, it's 99 cents every night. That's not right.
Another $1.50 every night.
Oh, I used one that was 99 cents.
Yeah, they raised the prices.
Okay. So the graph of renting a movie from Redbox would look like this. As soon as I rent it, even for zero amount of time, right, I press give me the DVD. It costs me how much?
$1.50.
$1.50. So for zero nights so far, it's going to cost me still $1.50. How long is it going to cost me $1.50?
One night.
Right? So whether I have it, or I turn it in 1 minute after that, 3 hours after that, all the way up until 9 o'clock the next day, it's still $1.50. Okay? But as soon as it crosses over, as soon as I hit that deadline, it jumps up to how much?
$3.
$3. Another $1.50 for $3 total. So it stops being $1.50 and jumps right up to $3. Right? On starting on the second day. Up to the third day, it still costs $3, $3, $3, $3, $3. It stops being $3. And after that, right, when you cross over to that third day, how much does it now cost to you?
$4.50.
And now it's $4.50 all throughout this day until the end of this day. And it just keeps stepping up. Okay? And it's that you're never going to pay them $4. Okay? We're using a simple example of one DVD over multiple nights. Now you're going to pay $4. It's never going to be $4. It's going to be $3, then $4.50, then $6. It steps up. It steps twice.
Over here.